Yo, what's going on? I'm Dizzee Rascal, and this is the story of Boy in the Corner.
I love you.
Okay, the years leading up to Boy in the Corner. So I used to mix jungle records. Yeah, I used to listen to pirate radio stations like Rinse FM, and I used to just love jungle and the music, the MCs, everything. And then Target, he lived in the estate next to mine, but like it was there. So I used to walk to like find out Target lived around there, and I looked up to him and that. I used to go and buy records off him. There's a couple of MCs in my area. One of them was MC Adar, who's a close friend who lived in the block next to mine. So I became his DJ. So I had a setup in my house. I used to mix and that. And then he introduced me to a guy called MC Storming. Over a little while, whatever, we used to go around and do little sets or whatever. He was in this crew, Nasty Crew. So then I followed him over there. And then that's when I used to MC with them, as well as my own crew, whatever. But then I started getting into producing. I was really into making beats. That kind of started on the PlayStation with Music 2000. But then in school, when I got introduced to Cubase and that, then I started using this other little studio over in Poplar. And that's where I made my first proper beat or whatever. And then I made a song called Ready for War, which had me, MC Armor, Sharky Major, who's now Grime Originals, that's his thing, and Storming. So that was like the first tune I did. And I'm reverting back to that because that was the first time when my sound, which is what Grime and Boy in the Corner and all that became. I know there's others too as well, but that's the earliest. And so now we're talking 2001, or maybe 2000. I'm sure I was still in school. So after that, I started going to our other studio, another guy called Danny C. Can't remember who's who at what time, but they both had studios similar. And then I made these other tunes. One of the other songs was called Crime, and the other one was called Boy Them About, but they were similar. I was sampling 3-6 Mafia records, one of the songs. Well, I sampled, made two different tunes, but sampled off the same song, which was Who Run It by 3-6 Mafia. So again, that added to my sound what I was like developing and progressing. I've been chasing Wiley around, bold, trying to get at Wiley. Oh, you want to show him my stuff? Because he used to go to Target's house. And they were just like the olders, some of the olders in my area. Or I'd be chasing Genius down as well, because I knew he owned Rinse. But at the time, he didn't want me on there. So these were just older people that I was just trying to get to show my shit to. Finally, one day, Wiley and Roll Deep were doing a session over in Southeast London, Bermondsey, with who would become my manager. Nah, Cage, who's their manager and Page Girl's manager at the time, and does production and all that as well. So they were all in the session together, and then Wiley said they needed a hook. So by this time, I'd already built a little bit of a name on some of the pirate radio stations around East London, mainly like Flavour FM. Another one actually in North London called Beat FM. So he called me in to help them do this hook on a song that ended up being called Bounce. So I came with a hook, and the hook was a sound of the Roll Deep Crew, Bounce. Bounce. And that's when the first time I put that lyric on there, Lyrical Tank, boxing MC, like my name was Frank, going on Dirty, going on Stank. Dirty Stank ended up being the name of my label or whatever, yeah? So that's how I ended up in that circle of people, like solidly. Even though I was never officially a member of Roll Deep, that's how I ended up from that day around all them. But then I started going there more. And like, because I was already really serious about what I wanted to do. So then that's how I ended up in there. And that's when the beginning of Boy in the Corner happened, because I kept going there, making more tunes. We were still doing raves. So I was making some tunes, whatever, because I knew I wanted to smash up a rave. Again, mainly instrumentals and that. And then just over time, just started making more. And then the important thing that happened was college. So I went to Redbridge College. Funnily enough, I went to Redbridge College with who would become DEE's manager now, Daniel, who I grew up with. I went there for, I want to say a year, but I don't think it was that long. I was doing music, obviously, so we was in these classes or whatever. And one day, I was on the computer making a beat. and I literally said to myself, why am I doing this? Why am I here? Like, I'm already known. I was already known from when I come in, that's Dizzee. Like, everyone knew who I was. So I just said, why am I sitting there? I could be making this beat in a proper studio and put it out on white label or something. And then I literally just left and never came back. I had all this stuff at my disposal, whatever, all these samples and all the things that Nick or Cage had built up over the years through, he'd been a producer and done some DJing and made techno, whatever. So I had all this stuff at my disposal and was just experimenting like a madman. And as much as I was young and had all this other stuff outside to distract me and whatever other bullshit I was doing and my friends were into and I was following them or whatever, I just still loved going to the studio. And it was dedicated because I'm from East, but I was going to South and staying there all night to just be in the studio. And then I Love You came out a few months later. What I remember is making the beat and just having this dirty drum sound, bass. Again, it was all spread across the keyboard. Just fucking just make this beat. If a girl know what you say that's for, some whore banging at your girl, what for? Pregnant, what are you talking about before? 15, she's underage, that's raw. And against law, 5 years or more. That she wants a score and a half hour draw. That's the kind of threat that you can't ignore. That whore got you pinned down to the floor, but shut on foot, you said three magic words. When that's the one for the birds, but you said that. And then I wrote the song. I was listening to Is That Your Chick? I remember Is That Your Chick came out. And I told you Timbaland's like one of my favourite producers. And when that tune come out, I wasn't a massive Jay-Z fan before that, but when I heard that, I was like, what is this? This is sick. You see, most things, once they get to a mainstream level and you're on TV and that, they're not that brave. But I just thought, when that came out and it was on the telly, the sound of it was like, wow, what the, like, this is fucked. Like, this is, like, sounding different. So that caught my, especially the structure, the call and response between the boy and the girl. I actually wrote the lyrics whilst listening to Is That Your Chick. So I was listening to the actual song and writing the lyrics along to it. Yo, some bitch, you know, she keep calling my phone. She don't leave me alone. She just moan and groan. She keep ringing me at home. These days I don't answer my phone. That boy's some prick, you know, all up in my hair. Thinks that I care. Keep following me here, following me there. These days I can't go nowhere. Ain't that your girl? No, I ain't my girl. I swear that's your girl. She ain't my girl. She got juice up. Oh well. She got jacked up. Oh well. There's this girl called Janine. I knew she used to come to my area. She like we used to go to the same youth club or hang around or whatever. But she was like a singer, and I was thinking of like, what girls I could get to come. And what I wanted was like one of the mouthy ones, one of them, like the troublesome ones. But then something just said to ask her. So I just waited. So I got this song. I felt like this song I wanted you to sing. I lied to her. If I would have told her what I actually wanted to come and do, I didn't think she'd understand. She might have, but I didn't think she'd understand. So I just told her to come to studio. Then I got her like to hear the beat. When she heard the beat, I don't think she knew what to think. Because again, to this day, nothing sounds like it. So back then, like, right, like, what is this? But she was up for it though, because she'd come all the way there. And I think she was just happy to be in the studio. That's all she wanted to do, innit? She wanted to perform and like, sing. So I said, can you say this? Like, say this. That got something. No, say it like this. That got something. And she did it. I was like, all right, sounds wicked. And then all that was like kind of from the early stuff that I made. It was just like a new version, like the early stuff I made. Like, so even though I was influenced by Is That Your Chick and What's Your Fantasy, I was influenced by the stuff that I made while I was listening to the 3-6 Mafia stuff. So even the repeating, I love you, that's some shit that 3-6 Mafia would do, the repeat. Like a line in their song. I love you. 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 And then I put my bars down and all that. So it'd be easier to actually show you what I was doing than explain it. But that's basically how the thing come together. And I remember give it on white label. I must have done it on dub plate first, because that's how I do put my tunes first, on dub plates. Didn't press everything up. I think that was like the first one that proper pressed up. Full song that pressed up on, like, well, it was on white label, then on my own label, Dirty Stank. I gave it to DJ Slimzy. I gave it to DJ Mactin, who was the other DJ of Nasty Crew at the time. And I just remember them thinking, like, rah, this is mad. And everyone who hearing it just thinking, this mad. A lot of people didn't like it at first as well, same thing. But then grew to like it because it was so different. I didn't know, I just thought to me it sounded sick, and that's the kind of shit that I wanted to make, some mad, just dirty. I didn't know what to compare it to or nothing like that, and it's even what I was saying and that, because that's just how I felt. I just wanted to make some different shit, because the people I looked up to were making different shit, and I wanted to be as good as them. It's some of the themes I was dealing with on Boy in the Corner, a lot of it was just straight rage, or just being a bit cheeky, just being a, like, just saying just outrageous shit, bit of social commentary. Those like the main thing. I think, okay, like, obviously violence. The one that they love bringing up a lot is the whole thing about Tony Blair and all that, the political starts, where it's mad because I never saw it as a real political thing. I was just being cheeky, like, I was just trying to talk, just being a kid talking up, think about how rough I thought I was. Yeah, I'm a problem for Anthony Blair, like, because at the time, well, when I was growing up, New Labour was the big thing. Things can only get better. Like, it was that old big campaign, Tony Blair, like that. So that was just big thing on telly. You see, like, using just cultural references. That's what I was doing, just a cultural reference. And then, but then I said it again, Queen Elizabeth don't know me no how, so how can she control me? And again, just as a youth, not understanding that, like, you don't think people are gonna really take into account, I've got a fucking MBE now, like, you know what I mean? You don't think people are gonna really listen to what you're saying, that, yeah, like, am I really a problem for the Queen? At that point, not really, I was just on my state, acting up. And it wasn't always all macho either. I showed a lot of vulnerability, and I think that's what carried it as well, a big part. Songs like Sitting Here, you know what I mean, and Do It, stuff like that, the stuff that got people through, whatever, life on a council estate, and shit like that. And that's, again, that's what separated me from being the Dipsets or the 50 Cents or whatever, because that's not what I was. As we just kept chipping away, whatever, just kept wearing the corner, just became more and more of a formed thing. And then it leaked, and I think that blew it up even more. I had to end up going and finishing it. I ended up blowing it up even more. The album cover was done by Ben Drury, and loads of different poses and loads of different stuff. And then I must have sat there and I just did that, because I just, like, it wasn't that deep. I just ran out of things to do because I hated photo shoots. I think they're coming from more of an arty perspective, so it couldn't just be whatever, I'd screw face and look at the car. Wanted to try something different, innit? And then that's what they ended up coming up with. So that's the short version. Well, obviously I can't remember everything, you know what I mean? I love you.